Hey, I'm Skylar. Welcome to Tech Edge. Wireless connectivity has been the norm for laptop computers for a long time, but untethered network access is an appealing option for desktop users too, especially in the industrial computing space. Now, there's a lot to unpack when it comes to choosing the right hardware for your wireless setup, particularly if you want to ensure the best signal and data speeds. We're here to help untangle a few things when it comes to wireless, so let's plug in, or in this case, unplug. The specific wireless card and antenna combination that's best for you will generally be based on three key factors: compatibility with your system, what kind of wireless network you're connecting to, and how far away you are from the source of your signal. The first step in choosing a wireless setup is making sure it is compatible with your computer and operating system. Of course, if you have a built-in wireless modem, you're probably all set there. If not, most discrete wireless cards plug into a mini PCIe and M.2 key E for Wi-Fi, or M.2 key B for cellular connectivity. Most cards use PCIe for Wi-Fi and USB for Bluetooth, so when choosing a card that supports both, be sure the slot you're inserting it into supports both PCIe and USB signaling. Next, make sure there are drivers available for your card of choice and the operating system you plan to use. Once you know that the card will work with your computer, you need to ensure it's compatible with the kind of network you'll be connecting to. Now, we could make an entire series about connectivity standards, particularly Wi-Fi generations and capabilities, but here are some key terms to understand. When identifying your Wi-Fi network type, you'll likely come across the 802.11 wireless standard, which is the primary communication standard for Wi-Fi set forth by the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, or IEEE for short. That string of numbers is less important than the letters that often follow it. The latest wireless standard is 802.11-AX, which is now also helpfully known as Wi-Fi 6. In addition to AX, previous Wi-Fi versions included A, B, G, N, and AC. Apart from 802.11a, wireless networks are cross-compatible, so even if you have a Wi-Fi G card, you can still connect to a newer N network. Of course, if you want the current highest performance from your wireless devices, you'll want to ensure you're using Wi-Fi 6 or AX equipment. And that brings us to Wi-Fi 6e. Prior to 2020, Wi-Fi could only be delivered on two specific wireless bands: the 2.4 gigahertz band and the 5 gigahertz band. Think about these bands like roads for wireless signals to travel on. Continuing that analogy, the 2.4 gigahertz band provided a couple of lanes for passenger cars and maybe some smaller trucks. The 5 gigahertz band opened up the road for additional signal throughput, think tractor trailer trucks and buses worth of data. With Wi-Fi 6E, the E stands for expanded. Devices can deliver and receive Wi-Fi on a much wider 6 GHz band, allowing for larger batches of data to flow more easily. You can think of Wi-Fi 6E as the high-speed commuter rail of Wi-Fi, providing more bandwidth and lower signal latency. At this point, Wi-Fi 6E devices are only beginning to hit the market, but the availability of the 6 GHz band paves the way for triple band wireless hardware with the potential to deliver data at incredible rates. Now, we've talked a lot about Wi-Fi, but one additional item to confirm about your wireless card is that it has Bluetooth on board. Bluetooth is great for connecting wireless peripherals and other devices directly to your computer. Like Wi-Fi, there are multiple Bluetooth versions, with the most current being version 5.2. Bluetooth is also backwards compatible, meaning all versions can interconnect with each other. However, as with wireless internet, you may lose some features when connecting to a previous generation device. Now, finally, let's quickly talk antennas. One of the most important antenna specs to consider is the antenna gain. Gain refers to how well the antenna amplifies the signal it's receiving. This is measured in decibels. The higher the decibels, the better the antenna will perform in strengthening weak signals. The typical range for screw-on antennas is 2 to 7 decibels. Different antennas are tuned to amplify different signal bands. Like many Wi-Fi networks, Bluetooth operates in the 2.4 GHz band. When buying an antenna, you need to ensure the bands you'll need are covered. Now, hang on. So if Bluetooth and wireless operate in the same frequency range, won't they interfere with one another? Great question. In reality, the two aren't actually operating at the same frequencies. Each band is actually a range with several separate frequency bands or channels that the devices use. To avoid interference, many devices dynamically change channels as needed. A 2.4 GHz or 5 GHz antenna can cover all of the channels within that band, and many antennas are multi-band, allowing them to send and receive signals across multiple bands, which will be helpful as more Wi-Fi 6E devices come to market. In addition to frequency band, you'll want to consider the size and quantity of antennas you'll need. Antenna size doesn't necessarily correlate with performance, so always check the decibel rating. As far as quantity, generally speaking, wireless cards have two antenna connections, and we'd recommend you use both. Although it is possible to get away with one antenna if your router or signal source is close enough, you should usually stick to the number of antennas recommended by the card manufacturer. So clearly, there's a lot to consider when setting up wireless connectivity, but knowing your usage situation goes a long way to ensuring you choose the right hardware. If you have questions about which wireless card and antenna combination would best suit your needs, leave them in the comments below. If you liked the video, give it a like and be sure to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time on TechEdge.